Well, we're going to explore some prophetic passages that are often overlooked in many Bible studies. We might remind ourselves of a basic passage in Zechariah 12, which is really at the center line of all of these things. Zechariah wrote 2,500 years ago, "The burden of the word of the Lord for Israel, saith the Lord, which stretcheth forth the heavens and layeth the foundation of the earth and formeth the spirit of man within him." Boy, there's a mouthful. What an incredible accolade to tie on our Father. He stretches forth the heavens. He lays the foundations of the earth. It's astonishing how few people in our country still acknowledge that. And formeth the spirit of man within him. He continues verse 2, "Behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling," or precisely a goblet of staggering, "unto all the people round about, when they shall be in the siege, both against Judah and against Jerusalem." And that, of course, characterizes today in broad strokes in any way. But let's go on. It says, "In that day will I make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people. All that burden themselves with it shall be torn in pieces," cut in pieces or torn in pieces, "though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it." What's remarkable about this passage is that it highlights that the entire world is going to be arrayed against this city. And at the moment, it would appear that the United States is getting pretty lonely in terms of its support of Israel. One could argue that in the final analysis, we too may be less than faithful in this pursuit. All the people of the earth be gathered together against it. So what we want to talk about, we're not going to focus just on Jerusalem today. I thought that's a good place to start. We want to focus on some of their enemies. And clearly, there's Russia. Clearly, there's Iran, Syria, and others. But we're going to discover there are some enemies in the Bible that may not be as visible to us today as these major enemies are. There's a place called Jordan. We want to understand because it's a strange exception on the planet Earth in terms of its eluding the reign of the Antichrist. Moab, Emon, and Ammon are three tribes that the Bible has much to say about all the way through that today we would summarize as calling it Jordan. And the Amalekites are also subsumed in this group. We're going to take a look at each one of those. Four disciples came to Jesus for a confidential briefing, and he pointed them to those four verses, the last four verses of Daniel 9, is the key to end time prophecy. How does that fit in here? And that, of course, the middle of that week is an event that triggers the Great Tribulation. We'll talk about that. And that, of course, the climax of that 70th week is Armageddon. But where does this treaty of with Jordan fit in? And we'll take a look at that. And this attack on Syria, I know of no competent studies I've seen that give us any perspective as to when Isaiah 17 will be fulfilled. The burden of Damascus, behold, Damascus is taken away from being a city, and it shall be a ruinous heap. Is that part of Armageddon? Is it something sooner? Is it something detached? We don't know. But it is something that's watched because Damascus is the oldest continually inhabited city on the planet Earth. And it would seem from a Bible prophecy point of view, it has a destiny of being destroyed. Is that going to be a nuke? Israel has threatened that on several occasions. And if they're pushed hard enough, they may make this fulfillment come true. We'll watch and see. But there's another passage that catches our attention, and that's in Daniel chapter 11, verse 41. In Daniel chapter 11, up to about verse 35 is historical. From verse 40 on, it is clearly speaking of the Antichrist. Verses 36 through 39 are an overlap. They're both historical, but they also echo a foreshadowing of this coming world leader. In any case, by the time you get to 40 and following, clearly the tone of the passage is dealing with the person that we commonly call the Antichrist. That's a tragic label for a lot of reasons, but it's stuck in the literature, so we'll stay with it. But it says that he, the Antichrist, shall enter into the glorious land, a term we assume refers to Israel, and many countries shall be overthrown. But these shall escape out of his hand. That's interesting. even Edom, Moab, and the chief of the children of Ammon. So these three groups, Edom, Moab, and Ammon, for some reason, managed to escape his thumb, if you will. We don't know why or how, but it does give us this strange, rather provocative clue that there's something special going on here. It's our conjecture that you'll see unfold here that one of the reasons they escape is to provide a refuge, a place to run, if you will, for the remnant that's going to be fleeing Jerusalem in accordance with Christ's instructions. But that's a speculation on our part. We're going to explore what is the purpose of the Great Tribulation. We use that term a lot. What is its purpose? What's to be accomplished in the Great Tribulation? And, of course, the prophetic role of Ammon, Moab, and Edom, which is a region today we know as Jordan. And Matthew 24, verse 15, talks about the abomination of desolation, which is a trigger in which Jesus' followers are to flee Jerusalem. In fact, let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains. Great. Which mountains? It's surprising to discover that those mountains are specified in the Word of God. That gives rise to another issue that causes a lot of confusion. Just where does Jesus return to the planet Earth? Many of us are fond of quoting Zechariah 14:4, where his feet shall stand on that day at Mount of Olives and so on. And yet that may not be his first return. He may have an errand to run before he reaches the Mount of Olives. Because there's this very interesting passage in Isaiah 63 that implies that he first returns to Edom to fight a battle himself. In fact, when you read Isaiah 63, it says, "Who is this that cometh from Edom with dyed garments from Bozrah? This that is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength. I that speak in righteousness, mighty to save." Who could that be? That's God himself. "Wherefore art thou red in thine apparel, and thy garments like him that treadeth the wine fat?" He answers, he says, "I have trodden the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with me. For I will tread them in mine anger, and trample them in my fury, and their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments, and I will stain all my raiment. For the day of vengeance is in my heart, and the year of my redeemed is come." Wow, what's going on there? The day of vengeance is in his heart. And that's going to fulfill part two of the mandate that he read in when he opened his ministry in the synagogue of Nazareth. So we're going to look at Jordan, Moab, Edom, Ammon, and the Amalekites, and then take a look at what the implications of all that are upon our two main topics, the tribulation and the Armageddon campaign. And we're going to finish talking about some controversies about the Magog invasion to get that in focus. So let's talk about Jordan. The Hashemite kingdom of Jordan is not an ancient kingdom. It is actually a European creation of 1946, after World War II, by the stroke of a pen, by an old friend of ours, by the name of Winston Churchill. He got a lot of things right. This may have been a big mistake. It's interesting that the League of Nations had given Britain a mandate to provide a homeland for Israel. But what they ended up doing is peeling off 75% of that land grant to create a Palestinian state. If you want a Palestinian state, it was created in 1946 by the British Foreign Office. It was called Transjordan. And that's the region, which happens to embrace the regions that are known biblically as Edom, Moab, and Ammon. Prior to World War I, the areas of Ammon, Moab, and Edom had previously been populated by unaffiliated Bedouin tribes. Of course, during the war, British and the Allies, of course, were fighting the Germans and the Ottoman Turks. There was a young major by the name of T.E. Lawrence that organized what was popularly publicized as the Arab Revolt. Very colorful. It was fanned by the media in Britain. How really successful it is a subject of great scholastic controversy. But in any case, it was a major event of the time. General Allenby was ultimately victorious in the Middle East, obviously. So the League of Nations awarded the British a mandate on April 25th of 1920, which was to endure until May 14th of 48, when the state of Israel was formed. And the next following year, an aggressive young man named Abdullah, he was the son of Sharif Hassan of Mecca in Arabia, he moved into the land east of Jordan with his troops. And so the British colonial secretary, namely Winston Churchill at the time, recognized Abdullah as the emir of Transjordan. That was just a stroke of the pen of the Foreign Office. Abdullah then consolidated control within his so-called Arab Legion. In 1946, after the war, Abdullah was crowned as king of Transjordan. And, of course, since then, his great-grandson is now the current king in Jordan. In 1948, Jordan, however, joined the attack against Israel's War of Independence, successfully fought the Haganah, and held the so-called West Bank of the Jordan. In 67, there again, it joined Egypt in the Six-Day War, and they lost it. And in 1998, having previously repudiated any rights to the West Bank, Jordan signed a peace treaty with Israel at Camp David. This has endured, interestingly enough. A lot of other treaties have come and gone. But it's interesting that they repudiated their rights, signed the treaty, and that still operates today and would seem to set the stage for Daniel 11:41. For some reason, there, you know that these shall escape out of his hand. When the Antichrist takes over, Edom, Moab, and Ammon seem to, what we call the region of Jordan, for some reason, seems to be exempted. And so it's our conjecture that this may be to create a refuge for the remnant that are going to flee from Jerusalem during the attack and during the Great Tribulation. And there's lots of references. We won't try to go through them all. We'll go through some of them here. But Isaiah 16 and Micah 2 are major ones you may want to jot down to look at your leisure. And so, okay, those are the topics we want to hit. Let's get at Moab and Edom and Ammon. This all starts, in a sense, back in Genesis 19. That's the chapter where Sodom and Gomorrah are destroyed. Lot is in a town called Zoar. He went up out of Zoar and dwelt in the mountain, and his two daughters with him. For he feared to dwell in Zoar, and he dwelt in a cave, he and his two daughters. And the firstborn said to the younger, "Our father is old, and there is not a man in the earth to come in unto us after the manner of all the earth. Come, let us make our father drink wine, and we will lie with him that we may preserve the seed of our father." They made their father drink wine that night, and the firstborn went in and lay with her father. Then he perceived not when she lay down or when she arose. It came to pass on the morrow that the firstborn said to the younger, "Behold, I lay yesterday night with my father. Let us make him drink wine this night also. And go thou in and lie with him that we may preserve the seed of our father." And they made their father drink wine that night also, and the younger arose and lay with him. And he perceived not when she lay down or when she arose. Thus were both the daughters of Lot with child by their father. And the firstborn bare a son, called his name Moab. The same is the father of the Moab, the Moabites unto this day. And when the younger, she also bare a son, called his name Ben-Ammi. And the same is the father of the children of Ammon unto this day. So this incestuous beginning is what starts the history of the Moabites and the Ammonites. They're regarded as relatives of the Israelites. And in Deuteronomy 2, it commands them to treat them kindly, despite those origins. At the time of the Exodus, Israel did not conquer Ammon. And that's not only Deuteronomy 2, but it's in Judges 11 and following. However, the Ammonites were condemned for joining the Moabites and hiring Balaam, were forbidden to enter the congregation of Israel to the 10th generation. That's in Deuteronomy 23. Rabbah Ammon is now Ammon, the capital of Jordan. That town is named after the Ammonites. So much for them. Let's get to Moab. We're going to have a lot to say about Moab. He obviously was a son by the union with the eldest daughter. We could go through the whole thing. We see him first mentioned really in Genesis 14. So the four kings from the east invaded Moab and overthrew the people of that region. And Moab, like the others, were a highly organized kingdom. Good pursuits. They were in very relatively fertile ground. They had splendid buildings, distinctive pottery, strong fortifications. So they have an organized history. They overflowed their main plateau and occupied areas north of Arnon. That's the boundary, typically, of Moab, destroying their former inhabitants. And so they shared these lands with the Ammonites. So they're closely related, the two of them. And just prior to the Exodus, these lands in Arnon were wrested from Moab by Sihon, the king of the Amorites. That's going to be another enemy of Israel. A very key event occurs in Judges 11 when Israel sought permission to travel along the king's highway, which crossed that plateau. And Moab refused. In spite of that, which is a major burden for Israel, Moses was forbidden to attack Moab despite their unfriendliness. And although the Moabites, from that time on, were to be excluded from Israel. And that's all covered in the books of Moses and following. There's a very key event that takes place when Balak, the king of Moab, is distressed because he can't beat the Israelis. So he hires a prophet from Mesopotamia, a very interesting character by the name of Balaam. He hires him to curse Israel. And Balaam can't do that. He's perfectly willing to take money for being a prophet, but he can't curse what God has blessed. But what Balaam does do, he counsels Balak on how to defeat Israel, because Israel's being supported by God, and if Israel turns from worshiping God, then they'll have success against it. And they get Israel to do that by having the best-looking girls camp along the fringes of the Israeli camp and start getting them involved, and then starting getting them into idol worship, and that's the strategy. The seduction of Israel by the Midianite and Moabite women is a major discussion in Numbers 22 through 25 and so on. And it's referred to in the book of Revelation and elsewhere. As we go through the days of Judges, Eglon, the king of Moab, invaded the Israelite lands as far as Jericho, oppressed them for 18 years as one of the six servitudes in the book of Judges. Ehud the Benjamite assassinates him. The whole book of Judges is, of course, the rather depressing account of failing to follow through on the successes of the book of Joshua. One of the bright spots in this period, days of the Judges, is when a guy by the name of Elimelech and his wife Naomi migrate to Moab because of a famine in Bethlehem, and their two sons marry two Moabite women, Orpah and Ruth. The husband dies, the sons also die. That leaves Naomi with two daughters-in-law, Orpah and Ruth. And both of them want to stay with her. She finally talks one of them out of it. Can't talk Ruth out of it, because 10 years go by and things are better in Bethlehem, so Naomi's going to go back to Bethlehem. Ruth insists upon going with her. And that whole saga in a little 4-chapter book called the Book of Ruth is a elegant love story. It's also essential background if you're going to understand the book of Revelation. In any case, Ruth ends up marrying a wealthy landowner by the name of Boaz, who is the kinsman redeemer, and ends up in the genealogy of Jesus Christ. It's that event that links Bethlehem to the house of David. And so that's an essential piece of background. As we move on through the days of Saul, he warred with the Moabites. But David lodged his parents in Moab while he was a fugitive from Saul. So a very interesting relationship between David and the Moabites. He later will subdue Moab and yet also set apart many of the Moabites for death. After Solomon's death, Moab broke free but was subdued by Omri of Israel. There's a long history of back and forth. Toward the close of Ahab's life, Moab began to break free again, and Jehoram of Israel sought the help of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, and the king of Edom to regain Moab, but the campaign was abortive. Later, Jehoshaphat's own land was invaded by a confederacy of Moabites, Ammonites, and Edomites, but confusion broke out, and the allies attacked one another. So again and again, we see an inability of Israel's enemies to get their own act together, which was salutary for Israel's point of view. In the year of Elisha's death, bands of Moabites again raided Israel. During the latter part of the 8th century B.C., Moab was subdued by Assyria and compelled to pay tribute. But after Assyria fell, Moab was free again. They entered Judah in the days of Jehoiakim. After the fall of Jerusalem under Nebuchadnezzar, Some Jews found refuge in Moab, but returned to Gedaliah when Gedaliah became the governor later. Moab is finally subdued by Nebuchadnezzar, and it fell successfully under the control of the Persians and various Arab groups. They ceased to have an independent existence as a nation after the exile, but they are known as a race and referred to as such in Nehemiah and elsewhere. And this brings you up to relatively current biblical New Testament periods. Moab and the prophets are often mentioned, and divine judgment is often pronounced on them. The Moabites and the Edomites especially are always on the side of Israel's enemies. We need to understand that. The archaeological story of Moab is slowly being unraveled. It's rather slow in the Jordan area. However, back in 1868, the Moabite stone was found, which helped open up the language in the 9th century history. It's now in the Louvre in Paris. And there's a number of sites that are starting to give us insights into the early Moabite history. But let's shift now. We're going to talk about Edom. Let's talk where that all started. It was in Genesis 25. Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord was entreated of him, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived. And the children, a plurality here, and the children struggled together within her. She said, "If it be so, why am I thus?" She went to inquire of the Lord. She could tell something was going on that was unusual. The Lord said unto her, "Two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. And the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger." And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. The first came out red, all over like a hairy garment, and they called his name Hairy, or Esau. And the word means robust, but in the outside hunting sense. Anyway, his name is Esau. And after that came his brother out, and his hand took hold on Esau's heel. And his name was called Jacob, or heel catcher, or Yaakov, heel catcher. And Isaac was 80 years old when she bare them. The rabbis make a big thing of this, that the war started in the womb. And Jacob had Esau's heel. Esau was trying to get away from Jacob back then. And it gets worse as we go. The boys grew, and Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field. And Jacob was a plain man dwelling in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he did eat of his venison. But Rebekah loved Jacob. So we get the impression here that Yaakov was a mother's boy. But Esau was the man's man, the outside hunter, and obviously had endeared his father as a result. And this course leads from here, the book of Genesis goes on to the most famous food transaction in the history, the porridge and so forth. But the descendants of Abraham, of course, he has three women. From Sarah, of course, we have Isaac. From Hagar, we have Ishmael. And from Keturah, we have a handful of tribes. From Jokshan, we have Sheba and Dedan, which we normally associate with Saudi Arabia. From Midian, we have a whole series of tribes that are typically roots of the Bedouins. And so if you're talking Arabs in a geographical sense, then you're talking Sheba, Dedan, and the five from Midian, the Midianites. But it's not that simple, because Ishmael has 12 sons, just as Jacob will have 12 sons, Ishmael does also. But Isaac ends up having two sons here, obviously, Esau and Jacob. Jacob is, in his way, faithful. Esau is upset for lots of reasons, and he deliberately turns his back on his heritage, and he deliberately marries multiple wives among the Ishmaelites. And the tribes did not keep themselves distinct. So the interesting thing here is that whether you call Israel's enemies today Edomites or Esau-derived or Ishmael-derived, they all trace back to the same tribal background, if you will. The press uses the term broadly as Arabs, but it's an unfortunate label because it has some other ambiguities. The Persians are not Arabs, and the Hamites are not Arabs. That means that Yasser Arafat was an Egyptian, a Hamite, not an Arab, not even a Shemite. So the point is, there's a lot of confusion whether you're speaking geographically or speaking ethnically, and most people that speak to this speak illiterately without any real understanding of the background. But anyway, the term Edom denotes either the name of Esau, given in memory of the red porridge incident of Genesis 25, where he exchanged for his birthright. It's also a term that refers to the Edomites collectively as a nation, if you will. And it also speaks of the land occupied by Esau's descendants, also called Mount Seir, the land of Seir. Now, modern archaeology has shown that there were tribes in there before his time, that they apparently conquered them and so forth. There's also gaps. There are issues here. It doesn't concern us directly, really. But Esau had already occupied Edom when Jacob returned from Haran, and he had tribal chiefs. The King James Version uses the term dukes, but they actually had 11 of these. I thought there were 12, but anyway. Edomites had kings before any king reigned over the Israelites, according to Genesis 36. The wilderness of Edom is an area that we want to understand. I'll show you on a map rather than go through the boundaries here. A very rugged mountainous area. It's known as the wilderness of Edom. It's not a fertile land, but there are some cultivatable areas. But that when you don't have cultivatable land, you end up having a militaristic tradition. And here's a rough feeling of the land of Canaan, if you will. But Moab just east of the Dead Sea, essentially. Edom to the south of Moab. And Midian south of Edom. And the Midianites and so forth. When they left the Exodus, they end up at Jabal al-Laws, which we believe is the real Mount Sinai, in contrast to traditions. But they find their way to Kadesh Barnea, don't make it. Edom will not let them cross, so they have to go a long way around. And that leads to the tensions that continue all through the biblical times. Because the King's Highway passed right along that eastern plateau. The major towns included Sela, Petra, Bozrah, and Teman. The word Bozrah means sheepfold, and that term can be applied to several areas that have a natural sheepfold topography. We'll talk about that in a minute. And so at the time of the Exodus, of course, they sought permission to travel the King's Highway, but the request was refused. And despite this burdensome decision on the part of Edomite, Israel was forbidden to abhor their Edomite brother, Deuteronomy 23. But the Edomites don't finish there. Later on, when Nebuchadnezzar is attacking the city of Jerusalem, the people on the sidelines cheering the Babylonians were the Edomites. Not a very good way for relatives to act, is it? And that's in Numbers 24 is when Balaam predicted the conquest of Edom. Balaam predicts about a lot of interesting things, the conquest of Edom being among them. And so Joshua allocated territory of Judah up to the borders of Edom, but did not encroach on their lands. 2 centuries later, King Saul was fighting the Edomites, and some of them were in his service. We find it in the scripture. David conquered Edom and put garrisons throughout the land. So it becomes a vassal area for Israel in the peak period. A lot of slaughter of Edomites at that time. In fact, Joab, David's commander, spent 6 months in there getting rid of all the male population. Some obviously escaped because a royal prince fled to Egypt and later became a trouble to Solomon in years later. So the Edomites and the Israelites have been at odds from the very beginning. David's kingdom proper is shown here on the map. The vassal states end up including the Philistines and Ammon and Hamath way up to the north. And the Arameans, Moab, and Edom acknowledge the sovereignty and pay tribute. So that was the peak, if you will, of David's kingdom, which went obviously well east of the Jordan River, which is the river connecting the Galilee and the Dead Sea. So there's as much territory east as there was west. The conquest of Edom enabled Solomon to build a port at Ezion-Geber and their copper mines, and that's where a lot of the commercial prosperity occurs in the days of Solomon. As you get into subsequent kings, there's constant raids on one or the other. We won't go through each one of these, but there's a constant warfare between Edom and Israel. We finally get to the time when Assyria is on the rise, and they take over the Edomites, among other things. And after the fall of Judah, of course, Edom rejoices. Psalm 37 is descriptive of the The Edomites cheered the fall of Judah the same way the Muslims cheered the Twin Towers coming down. And it became a cause for celebration. The prophets are full of judgments on Edom for their bitter hatred of Israel. Jeremiah 49, a good portion of the book of Lamentations. Ezekiel 25 and 35. Joel 3, especially. Amos 9. In fact, James will quote from Amos when we get to the Acts 15 event, which I'll come to. The entire book of Obadiah is a judgment on Edom. Anyway, they fell into Arab hands about the 5th century to through the 3rd century, overrun by the Nabataeans. The Nabataeans are the ones that built the so-called treasury at Petra, which we're going to look at shortly. Through these centuries, yet other Edomites fled to Judah, so there's a lot of intermixing here. Judas Maccabeus, one of the 5 sons of Mattathias, responsible for the Maccabean revolt, he subdues them, and they were later compelled to be circumcised and incorporated into the Jewish people. And now the key point to get a perspective here is when the Romans conquered Judea, they deliberately appointed Herod, who was an Edomite, Idumean is another equivalent term, as their vassal. So Herod, the Romans picked a known historical enemy of Israel to be in charge. And despite his elaborate building plans and other attempts to make himself popular, it didn't fly because he was an Edomite. And he's non-Jewish. And in fact, you could say anti-Jewish. There's another group that gets mixed up here from time to time as you read your Bible, the Amalekites. He's the son of Eliphaz. He's a grandson of Esau. So in that sense, he's an Edomite. But his name is a collective noun for his descendants, the Amalekites. And we first find them at the Rephidim, the wilderness of Sinai, in Exodus 17 and in Deuteronomy 25. Because of this attack, they came under a permanent ban and were to be destroyed. So there's aggressive language against the Amalekites all the way through. You may recall that's the famous battle where Moses had to when he held his hands up, they were winning. When his hands went down, they lost. So Aaron and Hur both stood on each side and held up his hands. But that famous event there caused them to succeed. But the Amalekites were their enemies, and they're defeated a number of times. It's very interesting that there are a total of 10 tribes that face Israel in the Promised Land. 3 are defeated before Joshua takes over in the days of Moses. That left 7. I think that's interesting that there's 3 and 7, the same thing as the Antichrist has. He's facing 10 kings, and 3 are put down and 7 survive. And the patterning there might be something to study there. From the days of the Judges, 2 major encounters. The Amalekites assisted Eglon, the king of Moab, in attacking the Israelite territory, and later forces raid Israeli crops, and Gideon drove them out. But from Exodus onward, Amalekites are to be found in the Negev, but for a time they gained a foothold in Ephraim, that's the northern part of Israel, but you generally associate them with the south, Negev being in the south. Balaam looked away to their lands from his vantage point in Moab and described them as the first of the nations, which may be in regard to their origin or to their status. Interesting phrase. And Samuel commanded Saul to destroy the Amalekites in the south of Telaim. That's one of the cities that we're going to be interested in the region of Edom. And Saul pursues him, captures the king alive, and Samuel slew Agag. And very interesting thing, Samuel told Saul not to take any booty, but Saul failed to do that. He didn't kill Agag. He took booty, and for that reason, Saul ends his... He has the crown taken away from him. But it's interesting that he was to kill Agag and didn't. Because he didn't, there's a descendant of Agag that becomes prominent later, a guy by the name of Haman in the book of Esther. David fought the Amalekites in the area of Ziklag. So they're back and forth all the way through the kings period. Haman, of course, is the villain of the book of Esther who plots the massacre of all the Jews. But it's interesting... the rivalry between him and Mordecai, of course, is the whole drama in the book of Esther. Your book of Esther typically would record that Haman was eventually hanged on the gallows that he had prepared for Mordecai. One of the problems with that is it wasn't a gallows, it was a crucifixion. That's a mistranslation, but it's commonly held. It's now in our literary vocabulary. He was impaled, and the Persians invented crucifixion. The Romans widely adapted it. But what's interesting here is Haman is a descendant of a king that Saul was supposed to kill and didn't. It's interesting, there was a Shimei that was cursing David, and his men wanted him to kill him, and David said no. He spared Shimei. From Shimei, we get Mordecai. So the whole drama in the book of Esther derives from the descendancy, if you will. If we had the time, we'd go through each one of these major predictions of the end time results. Obadiah will take a look at briefly. Isaiah 34 is part of a four-chapter section of Isaiah that's called the Little Apocalypse. Malachi and Ezekiel also have much to say about it. You might jot those down and check them out at your own leisure. And the whole region, of course, is desolate since the Babylonian captivity. Let's take a look at Obadiah, not the whole book. It's a little book, but just a couple of verses. The vision of Obadiah, thus saith the Lord God concerning Edom. We have heard a rumor from the Lord. That's interesting. An ambassador is sent among the heathen. Arise ye and let us rise up against her in battle. Behold, I have made thee small among the heathen. Thou art greatly despised. The pride of thine heart hath deceived thee, thou that dwellest in the clefts of the rock. How descriptive. We're going to see very vivid pictures of that when we take a look at Petra here in a minute. Whose habitation is high, that saith in his heart, who shall bring me down to the ground? Skipping on to verse 8. Shall I not in that day, saith the Lord, even destroy the wise men out of Edom, and understanding out of the mount of Esau? And thy mighty men, O Teman, shall be dismayed to the end that every one of the mount of Esau shall be cut off by slaughter. For thy violence against thy brother Jacob, shame shall cover thee, and thou shalt be cut off forever. And incidentally, the word shame is Hamas. That's kind of interesting. Okay. Well, let's step back. Having summarized superficially the occurrence of these tribes throughout the Bible, let's stand back and try to get the whole thing in focus. Matthew, at the end of chapter 23 of Matthew, summarizes God's primary theme. He summarizes the purpose of all history, the tragedy of all history, and yet the triumph of all history in just a couple of verses, 37, 38, and 39 of Matthew 23. Matthew 37, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathers her chickens under her wings. That's the purpose of all history, for God's chosen to be gathered together. The tragedy of all history, but ye would not. And ye would not. When the Messiah finally does come, announced in the Garden of Eden, orchestrated all through the Old Testament, when he shows up, they wouldn't receive him. That's the tragedy of all history. And because of that, Jesus announces in Matthew verse 38, 23 verse 38, behold, your house is left unto you desolate. And indeed it has been up until recent times. But the triumph of all history is then summarized. Jesus says, but I say unto you, ye shall not see me henceforth till ye shall say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. And from this, you really need to take a study of the book of Matthew and recognize that the rejection of Christ occurred in Matthew chapter 12. From chapter 13 on, Jesus no longer, he changes his whole ministry style. He doesn't speak in parables. He speaks only in public. He speaks only in parables. You need to understand that watershed. That's when the rejection occurred and, of course, gets confirmed when they crucify him. But he says, you shall not see me henceforth until ye shall say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. There is an event that's going to change that they have to come to terms with. And that's the purpose of the tribulation, is to drive them to the wall to bring forth that very event. Till ye shall say. In Hosea chapter 5, verse 15, very, very interesting summary verse, where God says, I will go and return to my place until they acknowledge their offense and seek my face, and in their affliction they shall seek me earnestly. Now, for God to go and return, he must have left his place. This, of course, is obviously an allusion to the ministry of Jesus Christ. He's, in effect, in Hosea, in the Old Testament, he says, I will go and return to my place until they acknowledge their offense. That's singular and specific. And seek my face. That's going to be a subject of Leviticus 26 that we look at in the next session. We'll take a quick snapshot of a pivotal briefing by the Lord, Matthew 24. Because four disciples come to him and says, how shall we know the end times? And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no man deceive you. It's interesting that he opens and closes this presentation by telling us to guard ourselves against deception. Take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in divers places. All these are the beginning of sorrows, or the beginning of birth pains. I want you to notice this group of signs that are clustered here in these few verses. Because Matthew's going to deal with what happens after these signs. Luke focuses on what's going to happen before these same list of signs that he alludes to them. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines, pestilence, earthquakes in divers places. So we find this list of events in Matthew 24, verses 4 through 9. We find it in Luke 21, verses 4 through 24. And we also find it in Revelation in the first dozen verses of chapter 6, that same clustering. But there's a very, very key verse. Matthew continues, then shall ye deliver. In other words, after that group of signs, shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another, and many false prophets shall arise, and shall deceive many. Because iniquity shall abound, the agapeo, the agape of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. And here we have the key pivotal verse. It's verse 15 in Matthew 24, verse 14 in the parallel account by Mark, and 13, they're almost the same all the way through. Jesus says, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. Whoso readeth, let him understand. Very, very key verse. It deals with a technical term called the abomination of desolation, widely misunderstood but clearly identifiable. Spoken of by Daniel the prophet. So Jesus himself authenticates Daniel for us, that he was the prophet. We don't have to worry about who wrote Daniel and all of that business. Jesus lays it right out. And he alludes to an event that occurs in Daniel 8, 9, 11, and 12, the abomination of desolation. Stand in the holy place, in the holy of holies. And then he adds a phrase, whoso readeth, let him understand. How many of you read that with me just now? Played a dirty trick on you. Because now you have an obligation to understand that passage. You need to get behind this, do your homework, and understand what Jesus is talking about here. Let's get the chronology kind of clear. Here's a timeline. Daniel wrote, let's call it, during the 5th century B.C., the return to Jerusalem occurred near the end of that century. The abomination of desolation occurred historically in the 2nd century B.C. under Antiochus Epiphanes. The Septuagint records all this. In other words, the entire Old Testament was translated into Greek in the 3rd century before Christ. The Olivet Discourse that Jesus is quoting is here in the 1st century A.D., but he's alluding to the abomination of desolation as yet future. We know a lot about it because it happened in the past, but that's not what Jesus is indicating. It's going to happen again. That's why understanding that event in the 2nd century is so important, because without it, we really won't understand, we won't know how to recognize it when it happens again. So that the abomination of desolation, it occurred historically in very clear terms. The word abomination is idol worship. The one that makes desolate is the extreme, the most insulting version of that. And that's erecting an idol in the holy, most holy spot on the planet Earth, in the temple, in fact, in the Holy of Holies. And it did occur historically. Much is said about it in the Scripture and elsewhere. And we can expect it to happen again. And Paul talks a lot about it. Once you realize what he's talking about, 2 Thessalonians 2 details it for us. Going another timeline, understand the the church period, which ended, which started in Acts 2, chapter 2 in the book of Acts, and it goes until the rapture, is called the church. It's also a term that Paul uses, calls it the fullness of the Gentiles. Followed by that will be the tribulation. The times of Gentiles is the period of Gentile dominion on the planet Earth. It started with Nebuchadnezzar, and it'll continue until the days of the Antichrist are complete. So don't confuse times and fullness between those are different. At the end of the tribulation, of course, we have the Armageddon, the kingdom set up, and so forth. So this final week, called the 70th week of Daniel, it's the 70th of a specified series of 70 weeks, 69 of which are fulfilled. There's a gap. We're now in the 70th week. And it's important that you understand that. I won't take the time to build the whole case here, but if you haven't had a chance to study 70th week, make that a high priority in your prophetic studies. You need to master that. That's a week of years, and it's divided into two halves, 3.5 years each. In Daniel chapter 9, Gabriel gives Daniel a four-verse prophecy. Verse 25, 26, and 27 are the last. Verse 24 is the scope of the whole thing. Verse 25 covers a period of time. Daniel is a slave in Babylon. He knows from reading Jeremiah that period of captivity is almost over. Gabriel interrupts his prayer and comes and tells him that from the decree to rebuild the city of Jerusalem unto the Mashiach Nagid will be 69 weeks of years, 7 plus 62 weeks. Then there's an interval because there are things that occur in verse 26 that are after verse 25 but before verse 27. So there's an interval there, which includes the crucifixion and the destruction of Jerusalem. But the climax of the whole passage is verse 27, which deals with the final week of years. It's the most documented period of time in the Bible, both Old and New Testament. And it's defined by a covenant being enforced by a world leader, not a treaty being signed. That's what's often inferred by many. It could be, but the language actually implies that a covenant is enforced somehow. And that apparently has to do with the temple, because in the middle of that covenant period, the covenants are violated, and the world leader puts himself up to be worshipped, and that's called the abomination of desolation. The period of time from that abomination of desolation to the end of that seven-year period is labeled by Jesus Christ himself as the Great Tribulation. He's quoting from Daniel chapter 12 that deals with the same issue. But I want to point out that's a 3.5-year period. This 70th week is called 3.5 years, 42 months, 12, 60 days. In either half, there's passages that deal with the front half and the back half. In each case, it's 42 months or 1,260 days. So this is not allegorical. It's not symbolic. It's nailed to the calendar, so to speak. Holy Spirit did everything but give us hours and minutes and seconds. Very precise. It's the most documented, most detailed specification in the Scripture. But the important thing to understand, people loosely talk about the seven-year tribulation. That's just it's loose definitions. The tribulation, labeled by Christ himself, is the last 3.5 years. The first half may be a time of unparalleled peace, a false peace, if you will. But it's not. If you want to speak of the 7 years, speak of it as the 70th week of Daniel. That won't be ambiguous. If you're talking about the tribulation, you're actually talking about a 3.5-year period, not a 7-year period. Can we get that and move on? Okay. Jesus continues then, when you see the abomination of desolation, then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains. Not those that are in New York or Paris or London, those that are in Judea flee into the mountains. Let him which is in the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house. You don't even stop to grab a coat. You get out and get out now. Neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes. And woe unto them that are with child and to them that give suck in those days. And pray that your flight be not in winter, neither on the Sabbath day. Why not in winter? Because often, not always, but often, Judea is impassable in the winter. It snows. Neither on the Sabbath day, for obvious reason. That means he's obviously talking to Jews here, not Gentiles. For then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, nor ever shall be. When does it start? When the abomination of desolation is established. And except those days be shortened, there should no flesh be saved, but for elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. And that's a technology statement. That's an allusion, in effect, to weapons of mass destruction. You can't visualize that being fulfilled with muskets and bayonets. This is a whole different thing. The Great Tribulation. He's quoting from Daniel 12. Reading Daniel 12, it says, "And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people." Both Michael and Gabriel have job descriptions. Gabriel is always on an errand of annunciating something having to do with the Messiah. Michael is a military warrior. He always is embattling on behalf of Israel. "At that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. There shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even at that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book." A time of trouble such as never since there was a nation of that time. That includes Nazi Germany. In other words, it's going to be worse. Jeremiah calls it a little different. He says, "Alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it." The focus of the whole scenario is Israel, Yaakov, Jacob. The time of Jacob's trouble is one of the labels equivalent to the period of Great Tribulation. Now, Matthew 24 is a key passage of prophecy in the New Testament. Luke has a passage that's similar but distinctively different. Many people assume it's like the Olivet Discourse because they both make reference to the wars, famines, earthquakes, and so forth, and they both talk ultimately of a cosmic upheaval at the end. But Matthew talks about the abomination of desolation. After this cluster of events, there is an abomination of desolation, and from that point on, he goes on to talk about the Great Tribulation, the time of Jacob's trouble, etc. Luke is a little different. He uses when he gets to the same cluster of events, he says, "Before these signs, a number of things take place," and what he ends up talking about is the fall of Jerusalem in 70 AD, and he warns his followers to get out of town, which they do. Church historians, Eusebius and others, have recorded that because the believers, there was a hiatus in the Roman troops because of Vespasian going to Rome to take over the empire because Nero had died, in effect. Titus had about 9 months there to wait until he got orders. During that period of time, you could see them camped around, but they hadn't sealed off the city yet. That was the time to get out of town. Jesus warned them. They took the warnings. And according to Eusebius, there were no Hebrew Christians that were killed in the fall of Jerusalem. Over 1.5 million of men, women, and children slaughtered in that siege, but no Christians because they followed Christ. And he said, "This generation shall not pass away until all be fulfilled." He's not talking the Mount of Olives. He's talking in the temple during the day in this presentation, according to Luke. And because that, it's interesting, that's the same duration of time that Israel wandered in the wilderness for 38 years. Matthew is focusing on something that happens at the end time. When he says this generation shall not pass away, he's talking about a different generation altogether. Interestingly enough, there's two first and last generations there. The seven letter seven churches fit in ahead of those signs, so you can go from there. In Acts 15, we're familiar with the fact that the big debate was about does a Christian have to be a Jew to be saved? Does he have to keep the law? And Paul and Peter go to Jerusalem to have it out. And they each had their say. After they had their peace, James answered, saying, "Men and brethren, hearken unto me." He resolves his counsel and says, "Simeon hath declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles and take out of them a people for his name. And to this agree the words of the prophets as is written." And James quotes from Amos 9, a very interesting passage. He quotes Amos 9, verse 11, which says, "After this I will return and will build again the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down. And I will build again the ruins thereof, and I will set it up." How interesting it is that clearly the book of Acts, clearly Paul's letters emphasize that God is not finished with Israel. Israel has a destiny at the end times. Many churches are blind to this because of the peculiar replacement theology position that they have held to. But clearly there is a destiny for Israel, and that's really what we're dealing with all the way through this briefing series. "That the residue of men might seek after the Lord, and all the Gentiles upon whom my name is called, saith the Lord, who doeth all these things. Known unto God are all his works from the beginning of the world." And it goes on. Acts 15, that famous council of Jerusalem. But it's interesting. See, there were two issues before that council. Most people missed the second one. The first issue was, does a convert have to become a Jew to be saved? And the answer is no. He doesn't have to keep the law, etc. That was basically what they're saying. The second issue that's implied here is, if He doesn't have to be. What's to become of Israel? James is dealing with here. Paul also spends three chapters of the book of Romans, chapters 9, 10, 11, hammering that God is not finished with Israel. They have a manifest destiny. The Palestinian covenant. This is the covenant in the Bible that the world is challenging today as we speak. Israel was granted the land in Genesis 15 and 17 and following, but it was under conditions of obedience. Many people don't realize this. In Leviticus 26, God lays out the rules. He says, if they shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers and their trespass, which they trespass against me, and that also they have walked contrary unto me, and that I also have walked contrary unto them and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if then their uncircumcised hearts be humbled and they then accept of the punishment of their iniquity, then will I remember my covenant with Jacob, and also my covenant with Isaac, and also my covenant with Abraham will I remember, and I will remember the land. The land also shall be left of them, and they shall enjoy her Sabbaths while she lieth desolate without them, and they shall accept of the punishment of their iniquity, because even because they despised my judgments and because their soul abhorred my statutes. And yet for all that, when they be in the land of their enemies, I will not cast them away, neither will I abhor them to destroy them utterly and to break my covenant with them, for I am the Lord their God. The whole chapter goes on four different times. God says in that chapter, if they don't obey me the first time, I'll multiply their punishments by seven. But what's interesting here is when Israel is in the land, it's fruitful. When Israel is not in the land, it's desolate. It's just a desert. How interesting it is, when they were in Gaza, the produce from Gaza constituted about 10% of their economy. When they withdrew from Gaza, the people that took over can't make it work and can't grow anything. They're all upset because it's not productive. I think that's fascinating. It's very literally true. But basically, Israel owns the land, but they can occupy it under conditions of obedience. So the first deportation occurred in 2 Chronicles 36, verse 22. It explains why was Israel taken captive by Nebuchadnezzar for exactly 70 years. There's a reason for that. God says, for 490 years, you didn't keep your sabbatical years, and you owe me 70. And so they were taken slaves. The land was given rest, if you will, to make up for those 70 Shabbatons. So and that's in 2 Chronicles 36, verse 22. The second deportation, obviously they were deported to Babylon. After 70 years, they were freed. Cyrus conquers Babylon, freeze them, they come back. That was the first return. The second deportation occurs in 70 AD when Jerusalem falls to the Romans, and that starts the diaspora. And the diaspora is regathered in our lifetime. At the end of the 19th century and of the 20th, there's the return, if you will, to the reestablishment of the state of Israel. And Isaiah talks about, when I gather them the second time, and that's exactly what we've been watching. But what will be coming is a false peace and a false covenant. We want to understand that. They're going to accept a covenant from a world leader rather than to trust God. In Isaiah 28, verse 14 and 15, Isaiah says, wherefore hear the word of the Lord, ye scornful men, that rule this people which is in Jerusalem. Who could he be talking to? Because ye have said, we have made a covenant with death, and with hell are we at agreement. When the overflowing scourge shall pass through, it shall not come unto us. For we have made lies our refuge, and under falsehood have we hid ourselves. Thus saith the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation a stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. He that believeth shall not make haste. Judgment also will I lay to the line, and righteousness to the plummet. And the hail shall sweep away the refuge of lies, and the water shall overflow the hiding place. And your covenant with death shall be disannulled, and your agreement with hell shall not stand. When the overflowing scourge shall pass through, then ye shall be trodden down by it. For the time that it goeth forth, it shall take you. For morning by morning shall it pass over, day by day, by day and by night, and it shall be a vexation only to understand the report. For the bed is shorter than a man can stretch himself on it, and the covering narrower than he can wrap himself in it. The Lord shall rise up as in Mount Perazim, and he shall be wroth as in the valley of Gibeon, that he may do his work, his strange work, and bring to pass his act, his strange act. The strange work of God. We're dealing with the tribulation coming. Now therefore, be ye not mockers, lest your bands be made strong, for I have heard from the Lord God of hosts a consummation that determined upon the whole earth. Boy. Okay. So we're dealing with the great tribulation coming. There are a lot of false presumptions about this period of time. A lot of them emerge from confusion between the church versus Israel. The church has been promised that it would not experience God's wrath, 1 Thessalonians 5:9 and so forth. This, the focus of the tribulation is not the church, it's Israel. And I'll make a challenge. I believe that anyone that thinks the church goes through the tribulation has two pieces of homework to do. To understand what the church really is in, I'm speaking of the mystical church, not organizations, and understand what the purpose of tribulation is. I believe they're mutually exclusive. It's not 7 years, it's 3.5. I think, covered that already. The seventh week does not begin with the rapture of the church. The seventh week begins with the enforcement of the covenant by the coming world leader, not the rapture. We'll talk about that in a minute. The purpose we've talked about in the previous session, in Hosea chapter 5, verse 15, the last verse of chapter 5, I will go and return to my place till they acknowledge their offense and seek my face. In their affliction, they will seek me earnestly. And then chapter 6 is the petition that the nation brings before the throne. In other words, there's a prerequisite condition to the second coming of Christ, and that's for Israel to officially ask him to come back. So what are the purpose of tribulation? To make an end of wickedness and wicked ones. And you can look that up in Isaiah 13 and Isaiah 24, details of that. To bring about a worldwide revival, according to Revelation 7 and Matthew 24, verse 14. But the shocking one is to break the power of the holy people, Israel. Daniel 11 deals with that. And Daniel 12, 5 through 7, literally says that. And we've looked at the others. Time of Jacob's trouble. Israel is regarded as God's firstborn. That's the phrase God uses of them. They went down into Egypt as a family, but they came out as a nation. And in Exodus 4, verse 22, God speaks of them as their firstborn. That's a term of position, not just that he's firstborn, but that it's of entitlement. She receives a double portion. Double portion of what's good, a double portion of what's bad in judgment. And you can look up Deuteronomy 21, Isaiah 40, and Jeremiah 16 to get into that if you want to do a study there. And the general description of Israel in the tribulation is virtually the whole third chapter of Isaiah. It lays all this out in detail. But when you get into this subject, you're going to see again and again another phrase used that overlaps this. And that's the day of the Lord, the day of Jehovah, or Yahweh, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. Ezekiel 13, Zechariah 13, Joel 2, most and 3, Amos 5, Zephaniah, and so forth. The Old Testament terms for this, the time of Jacob's trouble we've talked about, the seventh week of Daniel we've talked about, Jehovah's strange work we encountered in Isaiah 28, Jehovah's strange act in the same passage, the day of Israel's calamity in Deuteronomy 32 and all through Obadiah, the tribulation is the actual term used in Deuteronomy 4:30, the indignation, Isaiah 26, the overflowing scourge, the day of vengeance, the year of recompense, we'll look at that shortly, the year of recompense, the time of trouble, we've looked at that already. Zephaniah 1:15 uses a whole fistful of these terms, the day of wrath, the day of distress, the day of wasteness, the day of dissolution, the day of darkness. Amos and Joel also use that phrase, the day of gloominess, day of clouds, day of thick darkness, day of trumpet, day of alarm. These are all phrases of what typically is called the day of the Lord, the day of Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. In the New Testament, we find the day of the Lord in 1 Thessalonians 5:2, the wrath of God, Revelation 15 and 14 and 16. The hour of trial, The church in Philadelphia has promised that they will not experience the time of this period in Revelation 3:10. In Revelation 6, it's the great day of the wrath of the Lamb of God. It's very interesting to understand that that great day of wrath occurs in Revelation 6. It's so identified. Revelation 6 occurs as the opening of seals. Those opening of the seals occur because the Lamb has received the seven-sealed book. The Lamb receives the seven-sealed book after the 24 elders have cast their crowns on the glassy sea. It's very important to understand who the 24 elders are. They identify themselves that they are the redeemed. They're kings and priests, and they're the redeemed. The lampstands that represent this expressly identified as the churches in Revelation chapter 1 are on the earth in Revelation 2 and 3 and are in heaven at the beginning of chapter 4. So that should help deal with some of those issues. The wrath to come in 1 Thessalonians 1. The wrath in 1 Thessalonians 5, 9, Revelation 11. The great tribulation, we've covered that several times, and the hour of judgment, Revelation. These are all equivalent terms. Well, one of the things that the Scripture promises is, and we watch it happen, and that's worldwide anti-Semitism. It obviously characterized Nazi Germany during a period of time, but it's also starting again all over the world. The rise of anti-Semitism is, aside from those nations that are throwing rockets over the border, we see it in Russia, we see it in Europe, we see it throughout the world. Those who endure to the end shall be saved. Understand the abomination of desolation triggers the second half of the tribulation. And to get another perspective here, you can summarize the satanic role towards Israel in Revelation chapter 12. The whole chapter is a summary of Satan's role behind anti-Semitism. The result of that is going to be 2/3 of the Jews being wiped out, according to Zechariah 13:8-9. Hitler killed 1/3 of the Jewish population during the Holocaust in Germany. The Antichrist will kill 2 out of 3, according to Zechariah 13. Let's take a quick look at Revelation 12, which is an overview of all of this. There appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. Don't guess about zodiacs and things. That's explained for you by Jacob himself in Genesis 37:38. It's obviously she represents, it's an idiom for Israel. Jacob so identifies her. And she being with child, traveling in birth, pain to be delivered. Some people think that's the church. If it's the church, she's got a problem. She's pregnant. No, the church did not bring birth to the man-child. Israel did. There appeared another wonder in heaven. They behold a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. And you don't have to guess here. Verse 9 is going to identify him explicitly for you. Obviously, it's Satan. And his tail drew 1/3 part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered for to devour her child as soon as it was born. This is the verse upon which we infer, but it's inference, that the 1/3 part of the stars were the angels, that 1/3 of the angels are under his control. But he's getting ready to devour the child, but then the woman brought forth a man-child, the Messiah, who was to rule all the nations with a rod of iron. That's the identity. It's clear from Psalm 110, Psalm 2, and elsewhere. And her child was caught up to God and to his throne. And, of course, most of us recognize this and see that as, okay, that's the ascension. It was G.H. Pember, I think, was the first to suggest the possibility it might be a double reference, that it might be the body of Christ. There might be an allusion to the rapture simply because of what the verse that follows. The next few verses quickly put you into the tribulation period. The woman fled into the wilderness where she hath a place prepared of God that they should feed her there 1,260 days. There's that one of those halves of the 70th week again. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place found anymore in heaven. Oh boy. And that great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, now is come salvation and strength and kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before God day and night. That's what Satan is doing right now, day and night, accusing us. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of the testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, ye that dwell in the earth. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth. The earth dwellers are the adversaries that we find all through the book of Revelation. Woe unto the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. For the devil has come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. And when the dragon saw that he was cast into the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child. And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, to a place where she is nourished for a time, times and half a time, and from the face of the serpent. Time is a singular, times is a dual, not a plural. And time, times, and half a time, so it's three and a half. Again, it's an allusion to one of the halves of the seventh week of Daniel. A serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman, that he might cause her to be carried away of the flood. Several views here. Let's just keep going. The earth helped the woman, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood which the dragon cast out of his mouth. The dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. See, we understand that Satan's primarily addressing his war on the believing Jew. And the reason is, it's the believing Jew that collectively needs to petition the second coming of Christ. Satan apparently believes he can thwart the plan of God if he can wipe out the remnant of her seed that keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Christ before they make that petition. That explains something that's puzzled me for the years, many years. I can understand why Satan would fight all the way up until the cross, but I thought the cross settled it all. Why is he still at it? Apparently because he harbors under the view that he can still thwart the plan of God if he can wipe out the believing remnant. Let's talk about what happens in the tribulation from the point of view of Zechariah 13. Verse 7 says, "Awake, O sword, against my shepherd and against the man that is my fellow, saith the Lord of hosts. Smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered, and I will turn mine hand upon the little ones. And it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die, but the third shall be left therein." That's the verse that seems to suggest that two-thirds are going to get killed from the tribulation persecutions. "And I'll bring the third part through the fire, and will refine them as silver is refined, and I will try them as gold is tried. They shall call on my name, and I will hear them. I will say, it is my people, and they shall say, the Lord is my God." So there are some prerequisites to the second coming of Christ. Because of their disobedience, they'd be scattered. That's the diaspora. But there, in verse 40 of Leviticus 26, the iniquity there is singular and specific. In the Zechariah 12:10, "They shall look upon me whom they pierced." We quote that so often. It's not really upon, it's "look unto me whom they pierced," interestingly enough. And Israel's offense was the rejection of his Messiahship. And he will not come back on the earth until the Jews and the Jewish leaders request him to come back. That's basically what Matthew 23 alludes to, and that's basically what Hosea 5:15 indicates. And I'm indebted to Arnold Fruchtenbaum for his perspectives here, who really lifted the fog in terms of this whole issue. That Israel has a requirement, there is a prerequisite. There's not a prerequisite condition for the rapture. The harpazo can happen any time. It can happen before we finish this briefing. Some of you are probably hoping he will. I know we all do. But there are some prerequisite conditions for the second coming of Christ. That's why we know there's two comings, once for the church and once for Israel. But we'll talk about the prerequisite conditions. There's a handful of them. But what we're leading up to, obviously, is Armageddon. He gathered them together into a place called, in the Hebrew tongue, Armageddon, which is, the Har is just like a mount or tell, and Megiddo, it's an actual space. And if you go on the planet Earth and you zero in the planet Earth, there is a spot in Israel that is, Megiddo is just south east of Haifa. Place called Megiddo. And there's a huge valley there called the Valley of Jezreel, a very fertile valley. across the valley, on the other side of that valley, is a place called Nazareth. I always think this is very interesting because from Megiddo, when you're up there and take a look, you can look across this incredible valley and you, in the distance you can see Nazareth. I always think what it must have been like for Jesus to be growing up in Nazareth overlooking that same valley. And you wonder how much he knew when he came into his full knowledge of what was coming. Makes you wonder. But the Valley of Jezreel is the place. There, one can argue there really is no Battle of Armageddon. Armageddon is to Jerusalem what England was to the Normandy invasion. It's the place that the armies are gathered for the onslaught. And a technicality, perhaps, but it may be illuminating. So we have, according to the sequence in Daniel 11, it's precipitated by a move from the south, what he calls the kings of the south. Most people presume it's Egypt. That's responded to by kings of the north, whoever that might be, and there's several different conjectures as to that, who that is. But all of this really starts, in a sense, you want to start your study here in Psalm chapter 2. The second psalm is a psalm that you should take home and diagram who's speaking to whom. It's three people having a conversation, and you want to go through this. And I think if you do it carefully, you'll discover there are three very interesting people, namely the members of the Trinity. Psalm 2 starts, why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and who? And against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. You know, that is the most preposterous thing I can imagine. I can understand the world rejecting God. I can visualize the world not believing in God. I can't imagine the world knowingly taking up arms against God. That's too bizarre for us to imagine. And yet, nothing should surprise us. And that's apparently what's going on. In fact, that's what God is saying in his own counsel here. Why do these people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves and rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed. They apparently knowingly are going against God and his son, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. You've got to be kidding. What's God's response to this? He thinks it's pretty funny. He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. Indeed. Then shall he speak unto them in his wrath and vex them in his sore displeasure. Yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. I will declare the decree. The Lord hath said unto me, thou art my son. This day have I begotten thee. Ooh, boy. Ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the earth for thy possession. Thou shalt break them with a rod of iron. Thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Be wise now, therefore, O ye kings. Be instructed, ye judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and ye perish from the way when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all they that put their trust in him. Indeed. Let's shift to Zechariah. Zechariah says, I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle. That's not hard to visualize today. And the city shall be taken, and the houses rifled, the women ravished, and half the city shall go forth into captivity, and the residue of the people shall not be cut off from the city. And then what happens? Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations as when he fought in the day of battle. So we have the Armageddon campaign here, the day of vengeance, as Isaiah 61 would have it. The assembling of the armies of the Antichrist. Somewhere in here, somewhere in this scenario, the destruction of Babylon takes place. The fall of Jerusalem. Then we find the armies at Basra. What's that all about? Then we'll see the national regeneration of Israel. The national regeneration of Israel. That's the prerequisite condition of the second coming. And then, of course, the second coming. From Basra to the Valley of Jehoshaphat, and the victory is sent upon the Mount of Olives that we read in Zechariah. The assembling of the armies of Antichrist. Your passage would be Revelation 16. He gathered them together in the place called the Hebrew tongue Armageddon. The Valley of Jezreel is the staging area of the armies coming up against Jerusalem and thus against God, the Father, and his Messiah. Can you imagine that? Of course, God's viewpoint is one of mockery. We see it not only in Psalm 2, you'll find that in Joel chapter 3. Let's get back to the Armageddon campaign. The next thing is the fall of Jerusalem, described in Zechariah 12 and 14 and Micah 4. Over half the city is taken into slavery by the Gentile forces from the Valley of Jezreel, and so on. But what's missing, the armies are now going against Basra. Why would they be going to Basra? Because that's where the believing remnant has fled in accordance with Christ's instructions in Matthew 24. And Jeremiah 49 deals with this, and Micah 2 specifically. Basra means, by the way, a sheepfold. A sheepfold was set up so that you had walls on all sides except one entrance. And the shepherd would sleep across that entrance, so sheep couldn't get out at night and thieves couldn't get in. In John 10, in Jesus' discussion of the great shepherd discourse, he says, "I am the door. No man cometh unto me. Anyone that cometh in without, but by me, is a thief and a robber." That idiom is idiomatic of a sheepfold kind of situation. The world army is supposed to be against Jerusalem. No, they're pursuing the remnant which has fled to the mountains of Edom in Jordan. The place that's called Basra today, the place that was called Basra then, is a place called Petra today. There's several of these, but Petra's the conspicuous one. And it's in Mount Seir on the western side of Edom in southern Jordan. Micah 2, verse 12, pins this down. And again, the sheepfold had a narrow entrance so the shepherd could count his sheep, and then once inside, he could guard them. Selah, now called Petra, fits the description, shaped like an ancient sheepfold. It could have, within this range of steep mountains, you could have more than a million, maybe a couple of million people. And yet the only way to get into it is by a crevice in the rock, I'll show you, that's maybe 10, 20 feet wide. And a narrow passageway. It's called the Seek, sometimes C-I-Q, sometimes S-I-Q, which is a cut through the cliffs. There's a carved edifice that's known, strangely, as the treasury. It's not a treasury. It's actually a tomb, elaborate tomb. But you probably saw this in some movies. Indiana Jones used it for a sequence in their fictional thing. But it's a visit to Petra is worth it. It's often presented as an option on your tour to the Holy Land. It's really worth seeing for lots of reasons. It's worth going to. It's a very, very surprising experience. But this is what first greets you as you come out of the Seek. But it is a huge labyrinth of caves and tombs and what have you, many, many miles. So what will result here, though, is when Israel formally, officially requests, acknowledge Christ as their Messiah and ask him to come back, in the third day after that, he personally takes care of their adversaries. That's described in Jeremiah 3 and Hosea 5 and elsewhere. Pleading for the Messiah, that's in Zechariah 12:10. 3 days of campaign with their petition. And that will fulfill all kinds of passages. I'll let you take the notes and go through those on your own. Zechariah 12, Joel 2. Isaiah 64 being examples of that. And Isaiah 34, first half a dozen verses, specifically mentions Basra, the sheepfold. Isaiah 63 is a passage we'll look at here in just a minute. And the person there is none other than Jesus Christ. What you notice, his armies are not involved in the fight. He does this himself. Armies will accompany him in the victory thing, armies of angels and ourselves and whatever. But we're not involved. We don't have to do any fighting, apparently. He takes care of all of that. Teman and Mount Paran are also the same mountain range of the city of Basra and Edom. That's mentioned in Habakkuk 3:3. Micah 2 is a basic one. It's the breaker of the king, and Yotivavi the king, all the same person in this. Let's back up and remind ourselves of another event that ties us all together. Jesus opens his ministry in Luke chapter 4, in the early part of Luke. He comes to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he opened the book, he found the place where it was written. In other words, he looks, it doesn't happen on it. He finds the place that he wants to deal with. And he's going to read from Isaiah 61. And here's what he reads according to Luke's account in Luke 4. Jesus reading in the synagogue. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Period. He stops at verse 19 with a period after the word Lord. Then he does something interesting. There's a period there in your text, okay? He closed the book, gave it again to the minister, and sat down. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. He is declaring Isaiah 61, verse 1 and 2, in effect, as his mandate. He's announcing his formal opening public ministry. Familiar place, passage there. Well, what's interesting to do is to go look at Isaiah 61 from where he was reading. And here's the way it reads in your Bible, in the English Bible. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings to the meek. And he hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and to opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And then there is a comma. Jesus stopped at the at that comma, made it a period, closed the book and said, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. What's interesting to notice is what he didn't read. What he didn't read is, and the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all that mourn, and goes on. There's a phrase he specifically redacted out from his reading. He did not finish reading verse 2. What was that he left out? The day of vengeance of our God. Isaiah 63, the next chapter in Isaiah, raises this question that we read earlier. Who is this that cometh from Edom with dyed garments from Bozrah? This that is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength, I that speak in righteousness, mighty to save. Who is this person that's righteous and is mighty to save? Can you mention anybody other than Christ that's able to save? Absolutely not. This is him. The question is, wherefore art thou red in thine apparel, and thy garments like him that treadeth the wine fat? He apparently has white garments that are bloodstained. That's the way we see him in the book of Revelation chapter 19. He rides his white horse with a vesture dipped in blood. Not his blood. His blood was shed. No, this is something else. He answers, I have trodden the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with me. For I will tread them in mine anger, and trample them in my fury. And their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments, and I will stain all my raiment. For the day of vengeance is in my heart, and the year of my redeemed is come. This is the part that he didn't read in Nazareth 2,000 years ago, but is now due. It's his second coming. And he's coming back in with vengeance in his heart. Boy, that's a perspective of Jesus Christ that most of us miss unless we've read the whole scripture, both Old and New Testament. The day of vengeance is in his heart. And I looked, there was none to help, and I wondered that there was none to uphold. Therefore mine own arm brought salvation unto me, and my fury it upheld me, and I will tread down the people in mine anger. I will make them drunk in my fury, and I will bring down their strength to the earth. Whew. So, second coming of Christ. He'll come with in the Shekinah glory, clouds of heaven, according to Matthew 24, Acts 1. Acts 1 says he'll come in like manner, not in the same place, though. Doesn't say the same place. Armies, he comes with his armies, ultimately, in Revelation 19. That's in the plural. We got angels, according to Matthew 16, 27, and saints in Jude 14, 15. Apparently, both are involved in the return. But he fights at Bozrah alone, according to Isaiah 63. But he's going to come to Bozrah, the tents of Judah, it's called, and then Jerusalem. In Revelation, we see the wrap-up. I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he does judge and do what? Make war. Wow. The coming king. Lots of verses. Again, I'll let you indulge on these with your own notes and so forth. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood. That's what Isaiah 63 is dealing with. And his name is called the Word of God. That's his title. And from Bozrah to the Valley of Jehoshaphat, it's pretty much what we're seeing here. The Antichrist is powerless before Christ. He doesn't need our help. He takes care of it all. Antichrist's armies are destroyed, according to Zechariah 14 and Joel 3, at Bozrah, and then at Megiddo. Bozrah, by the way, Bozrah to Megiddo is 176 miles. That turns out to be 1,600 furlongs. The winepress was trodden without the city, and blood came out of the winepress, even under the horses' bridles, by the space of 1,600 furlongs. And if you go from Petra, or Bozrah to Petra, that's 1,600 furlongs. I think that's kind of interesting. The armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. Apparently, we're white and clean. He's covered with blood. Out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. Whew. Not the rapture, but the revelation. Not in the air, but to the earth. Not for the saints, but with the saints. He's come earlier in the air to gather us. Because when he comes in power and glory, he comes to the earth with the saints. Big difference. And one of the distinctives. Not to comfort, but to conquer. Not to protect us in heaven, but to rule with us on the earth. Jesus Christ is actually going to rule on the planet Earth from the throne of David, from Mount Zion. Some of us suspect that that throne will be literally the mercy seat that is being preserved for that day. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh, which is a typical place for emblems in a horseback combat sense, and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I saw an angel standing in the sun, and they cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God, that ye may eat the flesh of kings and the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men and the flesh of horses and of them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. Don't confuse this language, which is here called the supper of the great God. Don't confuse that with the marriage supper of the Lamb. They're quite different in their attendees and in their spirit. I saw the beast, the kings of the earth, and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army. The beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone. Revelation 19:20. Satan will be bound for 1,000 years. Jesus will rule for 1,000 years, when Satan will then be loosed and again lead a Gog-Magog event kind of thing. And Jesus will put him down, and he's thrown then into the lake that burns with fire and brimstone. And these two guys are still there burning 1,000 years later. People miss that. The beast and the false prophet were cast alive into the lake of fire burning with brimstone, and Satan is not for 1,000 years. He's just incarcerated somewhere. But after 1,000 years, he'll join them, and they're still there, burning, whatever that means. And the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceeded out of his mouth, and all the fowls were filled with their flesh. Boy, grisly, grisly, look. Now we get to the victory ascent on the Mount of Olives, Zechariah 14. Revelation 16, 17 following. Matthew 24, 29 and following. And Joel 3. Let's take the Zechariah account. And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east. The Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof, toward the east and toward the west. And there shall be a very great valley, and half of the mountain shall remove toward the north, and half of it toward the south. So there we are. Okay, we've been through each one of the elements of 1-1 sequencing here. I'm indebted to Arnold Fruchtenbaum for the background here. Many good scholars might see some of these things in a slightly different sequence. But in any case, that there she be. Let's talk about another issue that may or may not have anything to do with Armageddon. And that's the Magog invasion. We won't spend time in this quick summary to justify the identities, but Magog clearly dominated the southern steppes of Russia from the 10th century B.C. through the 3rd century B.C., from the Ukraine all the way to China. But they apparently arm and lead an attempted invasion of the Middle East. And we have them all mentioned by their tribal names. Gomer, Meshech, Tubal, Togarma, so forth. And they all are guided, armed and led and guided into an invasion of Israel. And it's famous for two reasons. It's the occasion that God intervenes on behalf of protecting Israel. And secondly, apparently nuclear weapons are involved. Sheba and Dedan are strangely not part of the attacking forces, but are standing on the sidelines saying, hey, you guys shouldn't be doing that. Now, the real question is, if we look at the 70th week of Daniel, the abomination of desolation, the great tribulation, we know that the temple must be rebuilt by the middle of that week because it's the area that's it's violated by this abomination of desolation. So it's obviously standing by the middle of that week. Jesus, Paul, and John all make reference to it. When is it built? No one knows. Many people assume it's built in the first half of that week, maybe even earlier. There's no way to pin that down from the biblical text. We know this week climaxes in the Battle of Armageddon, which of course results in the second coming and the establishment of God's kingdom on the earth. So far, so good. A classic placement of the Magog invasion, Ezekiel 38 and 39, is as part of that scenario. There are very good scholars, outstanding scholars, that hold that view, perhaps most exemplified by Hal Lindsey. Hal and I are deep friends for many, many decades. It's the only place I'm aware of that we have any friendly disagreement. We've agreed to disagree agreeably, but that's his view, and if he was here, he would be defending this view still at this time. But there are a group of us, Chuck Smith, Grant Jeffries, myself, and some others, that suspect, for some technical reasons, that the Magog invasion may be actually totally separate from and ahead of not just the Armageddon sequence, but ahead of the 70th week. In fact, its events may set up the circumstances for the 70th week. That's our view. Now, which view is correct is not our issue today. What we all agree on is an interesting thing, is that the Magog invasion happens after the harpazo, after the rapture. Now, that makes our situation rather provocative, because to the extent the Magog invasion seems to be getting positioned on our horizon, that seems to suggest that the rapture of the church is even sooner. Now, the Magog invasion, there are some circumstances moving in that direction. We could talk about that. Now, we suspect that Ezekiel 38 and 39, that invasion, is not part of Armageddon. The reason we suspect that is the invasion seems to come from the north. Armageddon involves the whole earth. Definite armies from the north are from the north, not all nations of the world. Egypt is not involved in the Armageddon thing. In Ezekiel 38, not explicitly. The Russian invasion is for spoil. Armageddon is to destroy the Jews. The seventh-month cleanup that is a key feature of Ezekiel 39 seems inconsistent with Israel fleeing. And the cleansing may be preparation for the rebuilding of the temple. 7 years energy requirement would seem to carry into the millennium. So all those things just don't seem to strike us as fitting in the situation. We do believe that Ezekiel 38 occurs before the return of Christ in the millennium. That's clear from Ezekiel 38:8. I'm talking about the return of Christ in power and glory and the millennium. It obviously occurs before the millennium. There, what confuses many is a reprise of some kind, a similar event also occurs at the end of the millennium in Revelation 20, verse 7 and 8. And you say, well, how can that happen? Well, see, Magog is a people, a population. Gog is a title of a demon king, according to Amos 7:1 in the Septuagint. So that could all play. That part is not really a problem. But what we do notice in today's horizon is the Russian Black Sea Fleet is being directed to its own base in Tartus, which is a coastal city in Syria. Syria has about 100-mile coastline on the Mediterranean, and the Russian Black Sea Fleet operate out of Syria, which is very ominous in terms of escalation issues here. Russia has signed an axis with Iran and Syria, and that's the missing link in the lineup, at least, for the Ezekiel 38 thing. We do believe that Ezekiel 38 is after the rapture, because the whole event, Ezekiel 38, God is openly, dramatically doing it for my people Israel. And that implies that the 70th week, that Daniel 9:26, that intervening gap is over with. The closure of the interval of Daniel 9:26. And all of this hangs really on perceiving a distinction between the church and Israel. They have different origins and different destinies. We need to understand that.